Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
And it's another solemn responsibility to me to be before you tonight. And I really appreciate the testimony of our brother, little brother Caleb. Where is Caleb?
He's not there.
Okay. And also, I really appreciate the testimony of brother Daniel. And praise the Lord for this, the witness that both you, youths, and more aged people can render, can give to the world. So let's have a word of prayer before starting our message. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for the privilege that you've given to us to kneel down before the throne of grace, your throne, Father. And we came in the name of Jesus to receive and to ask you to give us your Holy Spirit. Because we need, Father, to be enlightened by your light, by your word, and because we don't want to be and to stay in any confusion. Father, we ask you all these things in the name of Jesus, your dear beloved Son. Amen.
Amen.
As you can see on the screen, tonight we speak about the second angel's message. And I invite you to open your Bible with me in Revelation 14, and let's consider the message of this angel. Revelation chapter 14, and let's read the single verse in which this message is contained. Verse 8 of Revelation 14. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The angel of that verse could be called the second angel, because the one who followed him is clearly called the third angel, right?
Mm-hmm.
His message was not proclaimed before the message given by the first angel of verses 6 and 7, because speaking of the second, John said, there followed another angel. It cannot be either proclaimed after the message given by the third angel, because John said that the third angel followed them. And that's what we can read in verse 9. And the angel of verse 8 being included among that them. And as we saw in the first part of our study, the first angel was to give his message after 1840. The first angel was to give his message after 1840, because remember that John saw another angel in Revelation 8. And speaking of the first angel, he said, what? I saw another angel. Okay? Yeah. So the first angel was to give his message after 1840, and the third angel from the 22nd of October 1844. Consequently, the proclamation of the second angel must be located somewhere between these two dates, that is 1840 and 1844, and precisely the 22nd of October 1844. And I say this according to what we saw yesterday. Okay. And this message is focused on Babylon, of which it is also spoken in Revelation 17. I invite you to turn with me in Revelation 17, my friends. Let us consider that in Revelation 17, from verse 1 to verse 6. And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore, that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and naked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abomination of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. In these verses, Babylon is described as being a woman, and not a nice one, my friend. Indeed, she is drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. But I have a question for you. How blood can make someone drunk? How fornication can produce wine? It is clear that this woman is a symbol. And in Jeremiah chapter 3, let's turn in Jeremiah chapter 3, the book of the prophet Jeremiah, and let's consider the chapter 3 to understand that symbol. And in Jeremiah chapter 3, from verse 1 to verse 3 and verse 6 to verse 9, we read that they say, If a man put away his wife and she go from him and become another man's, shall he return unto her again? Shall not that land be greatly polluted? But thou hast played the harlot with many lovers, yet return again to me, saith the Lord. Lift up thine eyes unto the high places, and see where thou hast not been lien with. In the way hast thou sat for them as the Arabian in the wilderness, and thou hast polluted the land with thy whoredoms and with thy wickedness. Therefore the showers have been withholden, and there hath been no latter rain, and thou hast a rose forehead. Thou refusest to be ashamed. And from verse 6 to verse 9, the Lord said unto me in the day of Josiah the king, Hast thou seen that with that which backsliding Israel hath done? She is gone up upon every high mountain and under every green tree, and there hath played the harlots. And I said, after she had done all of these things, turn thou unto me. But she returned not, and her treacherous sister Judah saw it. And I saw when for all the causes whereby backsliding Israel committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a bill of divorce, yet her treacherous sister Judah feared not, but went and played the harlot also. And it came to pass through the likeness of her whoredom that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and with stocks. And I invite you to compare with Isaiah chapter 1, verse 21 to 27, Hosea chapter 2, verse 5, and chapter 3, from verse 1 to 5, Ezekiel chapter 16, from verse 15 to 58, chapter 23, from verse 2 to 21, and James chapter 4, and verse 4. I will give you back all of these texts, all of these reference before, because that will be recorded, and so the people who will watch the record, you know, can move the to go back. But I will give you, for those who are here, all of these statements, and when you compare all of these statements, you can understand clearly that a woman, okay, it's a prophetic woman is a symbol of a religious body of a church. So as I am saying, according to this verse, a harlot or a corrupted woman is a symbol of an apostate religious body or church. And that is so true, my friends, that the contrary, a pure woman is a symbol of the true church, according to what we read in Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 2, 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 2, and Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 23 to 27. Now, the word Babylon, which comes from Babel, place where the language was confounded, according to what we read in Genesis chapter 11 verse 1, literally means confusion. So the characteristic of this church is spiritual confusion. But the name of the church of Revelation 17 is not only Babylon, look at it, but mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abomination of the earth, which implies that she has daughters, right? Okay. Consequently, beside this woman, other religious bodies or churches come under the designation of Babylon. So, I have a question for you, another question for you. Which part of Babylon fell just before the autumn of 1844? In order to ascertain that point, my friend, let us have a look to some prophecies of the book of Daniel. As recorded in the chapter 2 of the book of Daniel, through the vision of the great image given to the king Nebuchadnezzar, God sketched out the human history from the time of Babylon to the end of this world history. And often, friends, in the Bible, prophecy, we find that God covers the same period of time using different symbols. And this is what he did. This is what God did in giving to Daniel himself a vision, as it is recorded in the seventh chapter of the book bearing his name. But instead of a statue with different metal, instead of an image, it's the correct word, instead of an image with different metal sections, God showed to Daniel the same kingdoms, but this time each one was represented by a different animal or beast. The kingdom of Babylon was represented by the head of God and by the lion with eagle's wings. The kingdom of Medo-Persia was represented by the chest and arms of silver and by the bear with three ribs in his mouth. The kingdom of Greece was represented by the belly and thighs of brass and by the four-headed leopard with four wings. And the kingdom of Rome was represented by the legs of iron and by the fearsome beast with iron teeth. And finally, the divided kingdom of Rome that we call sometimes Europe was represented by the feet and the tooth and by the ten horns of the fourth beast. And up to that point, my friend, these two prophecies run completely parallel to each other. But concerning the end of Rome, God gave to Daniel much more details than to the king, Nebuchadnezzar. Indeed, notice the report given by Daniel concerning the horns in Daniel. Let's open our Bible. Let's turn with me now. In Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7. And let's start with verse 7 and 8. And then we read verse 24 and 25. Daniel chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. And there we read that, after this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth, and devoured and break in peace, and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had ten horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were hisses like the hisses of men, and a mouth speaking great things. And verse 24 and 25, and the ten horns out of this kingdom are ten kings that shall arise, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue three kings. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of times. History clearly records that three of these original ten kingdoms were overthrown by the same power. In the chapter 39 and 41 of his book, The History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, the historian Edward Gibbon reports that through the emperors who were loyal to him, the Bishop of Rome overthrew the Heruli, the Vandal, and the Ostrogoth, respectively, in AD 493, 534, and 538. The Bible, now, the Bible gives us at least 10 ways to identify this little horn as being the papacy. First of all, it came to power after the fall of the Roman Empire in AD 476. Secondly, it arose among the 10 divisions of Rome. Third point, it began as a little horn, that is, a little power. Four, it overthrew three kings. 5, it has a man at its head. And you can also compare this with 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. And here, in this verse of the New Testament, we are speaking of the same power by the apostle. Its combination of church and state made it different from the other kings, which were state powers. It would speak great words and blasphemy. For example, what is a blasphemy? For example, and I give you an example here, claim to be God and to be able to forgive sins. And you can check the definition of blasphemy in Matthew 9, verse 2 to 6, and John 10, verse 30 to 33. It would rule for a time and times and the dividing of time, elsewhere presented in the Bible as 1,260 days or 42 months of prophetic times, according to the references that you can see here. And since a day is equal to a year in Bible prophecy, according to the two verses that we have considered last night, this power was to rule 1,260 years from AD 538, when the Ostrogoths, the final opponent kingdom, was overthrown until 1798, when the General Berchi, a French, made Pope Pius VI a prisoner and brought him in France, where he was detained in captivity. And you can check that in the book, The Pictorial History of the World, by page 756. And during this 1,260 years, it effectively reared out and killed many of God's children, without mention of the million who were brought to death under the papal persecution. And 10, and final point that I will make here, it would think to change time and law. And the Catechism of the Catholic Church contains this change, my friend. For example, the second commandment of the Decalogue was removed. The seventh day Sabbath was left for the first day Sabbath. And the tenth commandment was divided in two in order to obtain a Decalogue. And interestingly, 2 years after, God showed to Daniel another vision, as recorded in the chapter 8 of the book bearing its name. And let us consider this other vision from verse 1 to verse 14. In the third year, any problem? No? Everything is good? Okay.
Daniel 8,
from verse 1 to 14. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me, even unto me, Daniel, after that which appeared unto me at the first. And I saw in a vision, and it came to pass, when I saw, that I was at Shushan in the palace which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river of Ulai. Then I lifted up my eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns, and the two horns were high, that one was higher than the other. And the higher came at last. I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering, behold, he goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth, and touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And he came to the ram that had two horns, which had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler against him, and he smote the ram, and break his two horns, and there was no power in the ram to stand before him. But he cast him down to the ground and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore, the goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up for notable ones towards the four winds of heaven. And out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south, and toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great, even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground, and stamped upon them. Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down, and an host was given him again, the daily sacrifice, by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered. Then I heard one speaking, and another said unto that certain saint, which speak, how long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of the desolation, to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden under foot? And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And this is the prophecy that we considered yesterday night, right? So, it's a good thing, because now we have the context of it, right? In studying, friend, the first angel's message, we considered the verse 14, and we saw that the period of 2,300 years brings us to the 22nd of October, 1844. Let us have a look now to the context of this verse. It still under the symbol of beasts and horns that kingdoms were presented to Daniel. And according to the explanation given by Gabriel from verse 20, to 26, we learn that the ram having two horns was, and he's a symbol of the kings of Middle Persia. And secondly, the goat was a symbol of the king of Grecia, of Greece. And arriving here, we can clearly see that through this vision, God is insisting on what he has showed to Daniel before. But here, God gave to Daniel much more details than in the previous vision. Indeed, the great horn of the goat is Alexander the Great, the first king. That is what history reports unto us. So we can, with history, we can clearly see that this first horn, this first king, this first horn was a symbol of Alexander the first king, mentioned by the vision at that time. And Alexander was the one who overthrew the Persian Empire at the Battle of Arbelin in 331 BC. And Cassander, Lysimachus, and Seleucus and Ptolemy were the governors of the four kingdoms in which Grecia was then divided after the death of Alexander, that is Macedonia, Thrace, Syria, and Egypt. Now, the verse 23 introduced another kingdom. And remember, friends, remember that God gave this vision in order to insist and go further on what he has already showed. And so, which kingdom succeeded to Grecia in Daniel 7? It was Rome, right, Thomas? Rome. And Rome started its growth after having conquered Macedonia in 162 BC. And as for the little horn of Daniel 7, there is at least 10 ways to identify this power as being Rome. The first one is that, as in Daniel 2 and 7, he came succeed to Grecia. Second point is, it rose after the four kingdoms of Grecia and came out of one of them, that is Macedonia. Third point is, it was first a little one, but then he grew up. Fourth point is that in annexing Egypt in 30 BC, it waxed exceeding great toward the south. In conquering Syria in 65 BC, he waxed exceeding great toward the east. In conquering Judah in 63 BC, he waxed exceeding great toward the pleasant land. In corrupting some Jewish leaders, he waxed great, and it cast down some of the hosts and of the stars to the ground. And the eighth point is that when both Herod and Pontius Pilate conspired against Jesus, it magnified himself even to the prince of the host. 9, in persecuting and killing millions of believers, it destroyed wonderfully the mighty and the holy people. And 10, and last point, as the stone cut out without hand smite the feet of the image of Daniel 2, he shall be broken without hand. These 10 points are true concerning Rome, right? But have you noticed that in Daniel 8, God showed that it's Rome who persecuted and killed his people, while in Daniel 7, he showed that it's the papacy. Have you noticed that difference? And have you also noticed that in Daniel 8, God showed that Rome shall be broken without end, while in Daniel 2, the stone smites the feet and toes of the image, which does not represent Rome, but the legs of iron, which does represent Rome, the legs of iron, sorry, but the divided kingdom of Rome. Have you noticed all of this difference? Seemingly difference. But again, God gave the chapter 8 vision in order to insist and go further on what he has already showed in the chapter 7 and chapter 2 visions. And in other words, friends, each vision given by God to Daniel concerning the succeeding great kingdoms is more detailed than the previous one, especially with the last kingdoms. Consequently, the little horn of Daniel 8 must symbolize Rome in its entire history, including its two faces, which are the pagan Rome and the papal Rome. And thereupon, Brother Uriah Smith wrote that these two faces are elsewhere spoken of as the daily sacrifice, and that's why my pronunciation was different when I the tone of my voice was down when I pronounced that word, because it is a supplied word, and that's what we have in our Bible, in the King James Version, right? And the transgression of desolation, the daily desolation, signify the pagan form, and the transgression of desolation, the papal. In the actions ascribed to this power, sometimes one form is spoken of and sometimes another, the other. By him, the papal form, the daily, the pagan form, was taken away. Pagan Rome was remodeled into papal Rome, and the place of his sanctuary or wish, the city of Rome, was cast down. We learn here that the pagan Rome was remolded into papal Rome, which constitutes the taken away of the pagan by the papal Rome. In other words, friends, God considers that the papal Rome is nothing. God considers, friends, that the pagan that the papal Rome is nothing more than paganism under the clause of Christianity. And that dressing was completed in 508 AD. Year in which the influence of Catholicism has greatly exceeded the one of the open paganism. And with this background, we understand that the investigative judgment started by Jesus and the Father on the 22nd of October 1844 includes the exposition of Satan's work under paganism, but also under the form of godliness which deny the power thereof, according to what we read in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. And as we'll see, friends, in the next presentation, the message of the third angel exposed to the world the work of the papacy in its true light.
Amen.
But others' period of time are linked to the taken away of the daily. Indeed, in Daniel 12, in verse 11, Daniel 12, let's turn our Bible in Daniel 12, verse 11 now. And there, we read that, Daniel 12, I want every friend here, you know, the Bibles. Daniel 12, verse 11, and there we read, and from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that makes desolate set up, there shall be 1290 days. And so According
to
what we saw yesterday night, but before mention that point, I have to give you some an information. The margin says that to set up the abomination. So with that element, the verse reads as following: and from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away to set up the abomination that makes desolate, there shall be 1290 days. And now, as we saw yesterday night, one prophetic day is equal to one literal year. So these 1290 prophetic days are in fact 1290 literal years, and added to 508 AD, it brings us to 1798, year in which the Pope Pius VI was made prisoner by the Frenchman, the General Berchi. And my friend, 1798 is an important year in Bible prophecy, because it's from that year that began the time of the end, of whom it is spoken of in Daniel 8, verse 17, and Daniel 11, verse 35, and verse 40, and also in Daniel 12, verse 4 and 9. It's in that year that the book of Daniel, friends, has been unsealed. And do you know why? Do you know how can I say this? There is something that you must know. There is something that you must know. And this thing that you must know, you know, we have it in the Bible, in John. Let's open our Bible in John, the Gospel of John, in fact. Gospel of John, chapter 2. And let's consider John, chapter 2, 19 to 21. John, chapter 2, 19 to 21 is a proof of that. Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and it's 3 days I will raise it up. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? But he spake of the temple of his body. As it took 46 years to the Jewish to restore the earthly temple, it also took 46 years to God's people to restore the doctrine of the heavenly temple since the unsealing of the book of Daniel. You know, when you have something like that, you can clearly see that the Bible is not something wrong. You know, Pastor Harlan have a degree in mathematics, you know, and I myself, I am a surveyor. This is my qualification that I have. But you know, God, all along the year of the history of this year, he gave all this prophecy, and you have a repetition, friends, of the rebuilding of the earthly temple. And this period of time, we see it took 46 years to the Advent people to restore the doctrine of the heavenly temple. Then in verse 12 of, Let's return to Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12. And let's read verse 12. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,335 days. And when you do the maths, again, it is simple, friend. One prophetic day is equal to one literal year. So this period of time, these 35 prophetic days are in fact 1,335 literal year. And added, because it is in relation to the previous period of time, and added to 508 AD, it brings us to 1,843. Right, that's right. And the Bible, friends, the Bible says that you are blessed. When you reach that time, you are blessed. But why are you blessed when you reach that time? When you reach 1,843? It's because it is in that year that the first angel's message was greatly proclaimed to prepare a people for the judgment, the final work of Christ's ministry. And consequently, my friend, the second angel's message must be located now. In the beginning of the presentation, I said unto you, between 1,840, but now I can tell you it's between 1,843 and the autumn, or the 22nd of October, 1,844, as we ascertained last night. Through that prophetic sketch that we found in the book of Daniel, we got the evidence that the Roman Catholic Church, my friend, and listen that very well, under the dictatorship of the Bishop of Rome during the 12 and 60 years, is the mother of harlots, drinking with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, according to what we read in Revelation chapter 17, from verse 3 to 6. And the reason of this bloodshed was due to the wine of her fornication. When the scripture tells us to avoid strong drink like wine, it's in order to stay the temple of the Holy Spirit of God, according to what we read in Luke chapter 1 and verse 15 and Ephesians chapter 5 verse 18. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, let's turn our Bible in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17. And there we read that, but he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. He that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Friends, it's through his spirit that the believers are one with Jesus. And concerning that spirit, he says now in John chapter 6, verse 63, let's turn now to John chapter 6, and let's consider verse 63. John chapter 6, verse 63. It is a spirit that quickeneth the flesh. It is a spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirits and they are life. From these verses, when we learn that the life and the spirits of Christ are imparted to the believers, in fact, from these verses, we learn that the word and the life and the spirit of Christ are imparted to the believers through the word of Jesus, and puts in other word, through the doctrine of Jesus, right? But as soon as the believers accept teachings which are not of Jesus, his word can no longer have any effect on the believers. And then they cease to receive his life and his spirit. Thus, wine is a symbol of false teachings. Now, notice the character of this wine. Let us return now to Revelation chapter 17. Revelation chapter 17. And let's read, and let's pay attention to verse 2, the second verse of chapter 17 of Revelation. So we are John is the report here of Babylon, and he says concerning Babylon, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. In AD 533, the Emperor Justinian decreed that the Bishop of Rome was to rule supreme over all the churches. And that could not happen, friend, until the complete overthrow of the Heruli, the Vandals, and the Ostrogoths. And why? And why that could not happen? It's because since the Council of Nicaea in AD 325, a theologian named Athanasius led the Church of Rome to adopt the doctrine of the Trinity. But the people of these three kingdoms were attached to the faith of Arius. The opponent theologian of Athanasius, who believed that Jesus was created before all things. Which camp was fighting the good fight of faith, my friends? No one. None of them. Because the faith says that, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6. But also, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's what we read in, what we can read in John, verse chapter 3, verse 16. So, because of their refusal to worship its God, the Trinity, the Church of Rome, the Roman Catholic Church, used the civil power to persecute and kill millions of people. But the doctrine, my friend, the doctrine of the Trinity was not the only false teaching concern. For example, and as reported a few minutes ago, there was the change, and I put change in, what is the? Okay, in this two mark, because they cannot change the law, my friend. The Pope cannot change the law of God. Amen? So they attempted to change, okay, the second commandment by allowing the people to bow down before graven images. The change of the fourth commandment by teaching and forcing the people to leave the observation of the 7-day Sabbath and to observe the so-called Lord's Day on the first day of the week, that is Sunday, but also the immortality of the soul instead of mortal man, according to what we can read in Job chapter 4, verse 17. The Eucharist instead of the Lord's Supper and one death, Hebrews 9, verse 28. And the sprinkling instead of immersion, which is the only scriptural mode of baptism and a fitting memorial of burial and resurrection of our Lord, for which purpose it was designed. With all these heresies taught and practiced long time before 1798, do you think that the Church of Rome, the Roman Catholic Church, do you think that the Church of Rome could be the Church of Christ during the 12 and 60 years?
No.
That cannot be. No, because in 1 Timothy, right? You can help me. Okay, thank you, brother. Okay. Let's open our Bible in 1 Timothy. In 1 Timothy. And I was saying that could not happen, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 15. And let us read why Rome was not the Church of God during the 12 and 60 years. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 15. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, and the pillar and ground of the herald. Of the truth.
Amen.
The church is the pillar of the truth.
Amen.
Thus, the fact that it was not the Church of Christ under the 12 and 60 years is a proof that the Church of Rome had already fallen before 1798. And I precise this, friend, because the fall of Babylon announced in Revelation chapter 14 occurred after 1843, according to what we learned in the beginning of this study. It occurred in 1843 and before the autumn of 1844. Consequently, my friend, the Babylon mentioned here cannot be the Church of Rome, the mother of harlots. It cannot be her. So who is concerned in Revelation chapter 14? Her daughters. Her daughters. But who are they? In order to respond to this question, we need to establish something, my friend. A woman does not born harlot.
It's not born.
He does not born, a woman does not born harlot, but she becomes a harlot. And plus, prostitution is not a person, my friend. Prostitution, it's a behavior. So who are these daughters of the harlots of Revelation 14? Who are these churches who once pure became harlots in following the behavior and the teachings of the Church of Rome, the mother of harlots? Without a shadow of doubt, it is the Protestant churches, those who cease to protest and clinging to the doctrines of the Rome, of the Church of Rome, and in following her example to form an unlawful alliance with the world. James White was a pastor who lived in the United States of America, and he experimented the fulfillment of the threefold message of Revelation 14. And concerning the example of Rome followed by the Protestant churches, he wrote that the first message was to the churches, but soon their papers refused to publish it, and the doors of their house, of the houses of worship, were closed against it. They rejected the good news of the coming kingdom, and Jesus and the Spirit of Truth departed from them, as their present state plainly shows. The few living souls in all these churches who had received the Advent message and who loved to talk of the Advent and the restitution were not allowed to speak freely of their faith and hope, their testimony being crushed. The way was fully prepared for the second coming, for the second message, which is Babylon is fallen, etc. This message we heard, how voices proclaimed it, and we saw its effects when the oppressed children of God burnt the band that bound them to the various church.
Can you go back real quick?
The various church. Sex, you were saying.
Can you go back real quick to get that reference? Yeah.
And concerning, I will wait my brother, that my brother finished to vote the statement. But don't worry, I will give you that, you know. I'll give you my email and I will send you the reference, no problem. And concerning the doctrine of Rome maintained by the Protestant churches, he also wrote, that as fundamental errors, we might class with this counterfeit Sabbath other errors which Protestants have brought away from the Catholic Church, such as sprinkling for baptism, the Trinity, the consciousness of the death and the eternal life in misery. The mass who have held these fundamental errors have doubtless done it ignorantly, but can it be supposed that the Church of Christ will carry along with her these errors till the judgment scenes burst upon the world? We think not. Now, I would like to draw your attention to a point. Let's turn up the page of our Bible in Revelation chapter 14, and let's consider again the second message. Revelation chapter 14, and let's consider the verse 8. Revelation chapter 14, verse 8. And there, we read that, and there followed, Revelation chapter 14, verse 8, okay. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Babylon is fallen because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The word translated by fallen comes from the Greek root word pipto, which could mean to descend from an higher place to a lower, and metaphorically to fall under judgment, came under condemnation, according to Tyrus' Greek lexicon. Friends, Babylon fell because of sins she made all nations drink of her wine. This does not mean that she was not an embodiment of religious confusion before that time, but that since she made all nations drink of her wine, its spiritual confusion reached a high level so that she came under God's condemnation. But this verse is also connected to others verses in the book of Revelation. And let's now turn a Bible, the page of a Bible, to Revelation chapter 18. And let's read the three first verses of this chapter. Revelation 18 from verse 1 to 3. Revelation 18 started from verse 1 and to verse 3. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and he become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every false spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. The angel here that we consider as being the fourth represents a movement who repeats the second angel's message with an additional of all different elements. Indeed, in Revelation 14, Babylon is fallen because, Hoti, she made, Potizo, all nations drink of the wrath of her fornication. But in Revelation 18, Babylon is fallen for, Hoti, all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. What does that mean? The Greek root translated by because in Revelation 14 and by for in Revelation 18 is hoti, which means because or since, according to Tyre's Greek English lexicon. And so this is for Revelation 18. But there is a missing word, my friend. There is a missing word in Revelation 18, which is potizo. And this Greek word, which was translated by med, means to give to drink, to furnish drink, to water, irrigate. Always according to Tyrus' Greek lexicon. Put in another way, Revelation 18 speaks of a time when all nations have accepted the wine given by Babylon, the mother, but also her daughters. And consequently, my friend, the fourth angel's message announced that Babylon has fully reached the condition foretold by the second angel's message. And after that, after the message that we just read from verse 1 to verse 2, another message is given by another agent. And let's read. Let's read. Started from verse 4. Let's read verse 4 and 5 of Revelation 18. Revelation 18, verse 4 and 5. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Has not the mother fallen before the 12 and 60 years? Yes. But it's only when her daughters joined her that God announced that Babylon is fallen. And as not the believers came out of her before 1844? Yes. But it's only when all nations have drunk of her wine, when her sins have reached unto heaven, that God announced that having connection with her becomes a motive to receive her plagues. And friends, the Roman Catholic Church is training the Protestant churches to follow her in her behavior and her doctrines. And we have been told that the mystery of the Trinity is the central doctrine of the Catholic faith. Upon it are based all the other teachings of the Church. And interestingly, my friend, mystery is the first element written upon the forehead of the mother of harlots. But it is different. That scripture, it's different, my friend. It's different on the foreheads of the people that John saw before the vision of the threefold message. Let's consider this in Revelation 14. And let's consider Revelation 14, verse 1, 4, and 5. Revelation 14, verse 1, 4, and 5. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. Verse 4, these are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Friend, a wife cannot defile his husband unless she is a harlot. So these people are virgins because they have a pure faith. These people, my friend, they are virgin. Let me repeat that for you. They are virgin because they are a pure faith. Amen. Not because they don't have connection with any churches, but because they don't have connection with any fallen churches. Amen. And when we can be sure that among the 444,000 thank you, Master. And we can be sure that among the 144,000, there will be no Trinitarian, my friend.
Amen.
There will be no Sunday keeper, no believer in the immortality of the soul, no participant in the Eucharist, and no people whose baptism has been a sprinkling. Friends, do we want to have the Father's name written upon our foreheads? If yes, then we must follow the Lamb, Jesus, whithersoever he goeth. And now, Jesus, he is pleading his blood in our behalf before the ark of the covenant of God in heaven, in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And soon, because we are living in the early years of the sounding of the seventh trumpet, he will cease his solemn work of high priest, and the plagues shall be poured out on this earth, especially on Babylon. Again, will we continue to have connection with these harlots who are teaching to the world how to transgress the commandment of God? No, I don't want that, my friend. We should not have any connection with these churches. Nor the Roman Catholic churches. Nor the Lutheran churches. Nor the Methodist churches. Nor the Calvinist churches. Whatever the name of the churches. Even the Seventh-day Adventist churches, my friend.
Amen.
We should not have any connection with these fallen churches, my friend. It's not me. It's the Bible. Your Bible. We should not have any connection with these fallen churches, my friend. Because a woman cannot defile his husband unless she is a harlot. You know, many people, when you are preaching in this message, they said, well, so we should be alone and isolate. No, that's what not the Bible is teaching, my friend. The problem is not the woman. It is her behavior. The problem is not the church. The problem is the behavior of the church. And this is a behavior that which made all of these churches harlots. So whatever is the name of the churches, if this church is not the pillar of the truth, my friend, we should not have any connection with them, because we cannot be among the 144,000. That will not happen, my friend. And I don't want that. I don't want to be led by these fallen churches. And I hope that it will be the same for you, my friend. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this message of freedom, of liberty. It may be for us a difficult thing to hear, but you are the God of liberty. Your law is a law of liberty. And we want to be in liberty. We want to be in the light and no more in confusion. So we ask you, Father, to give us your light. And give us understanding and discernment that we may follow Jesus, the Lamb, your Lamb, whithersoever he goeth. Father, thank you so much for this precious message that you sent unto us long time ago. And this message is a present message, is still a present message, even if he was given long time ago. But you sent a fourth angel to give power to this three message, Father. and we want to follow you, whether to heaven, that your Lamb, Jesus, goeth. Father, I ask you for all these, the souls who are in the valley of uncertainty tonight, to make, I ask you to give them your Holy Spirit, that they may take a decision, and that they may be prepared, that they may prepare themselves to be among the 144,000. That's why I ask you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, what a message, huh? What a blessing. I have just a couple announcements, if I may, please.